Okay. So, are you ready for the hands-on session?
Yes.
Good. Rahul has said he wanted to help me.
I'm awake.
Okay. You're awake. Okay, I shall see how far I get without your help. Oh, yes. You are blinded. Better? I think now it's fine, right? Oh no, you guys have nothing now. Okay. So, what is this problem? So, the problem is a question of how you solve the radiative transfer equations, and because it is too complicated to discuss radiative transfer as they are implemented in the hydrodynamics, I've given you a very brief flash on how this can be solved for calculating column densities and attenuations of the external radiation field. Now the question is what happens if you have an internal radiation field. So the system is a core, a blob of gas that has a star in the middle. And it has, we start out with a dusty envelope around the star, and the dust has a certain power law dependence. I think rho is proportional, no, equal to rho zero and r to the minus 1.8 power, and of course r zero. R of R0 to minus 1.8 power. So this is our initial configuration, and we want to compute spectral energy distributions where we ask the question, now, what would an observer see if he puts a spectrograph onto this object? What would be the intensity or the flux U of, let's call it this function of lambda, what would you see? So this is a typical post-processing question that people who work on protostars or molecular cloud cores would have. And the idea is to, where is my, oh, the resolution is smaller, so I need to do something. And one of the codes that can do that very nicely is the RADMC code. Where is it? Here. So you have all downloaded this code. It is a Monte Carlo-based radiative transfer code. I wanted to briefly discuss the different approaches to solve the hydro, not the hydro, the equations of radiative transfer. Basically, what you do here is you have a central source. And let's say here is your observer, and you send out photon packages, they may scatter then into the line of sight. So you shoot out many, many photon packages, and you're looking where these end up and what happens to them. So a very simple approximation, you put yourself on a ray, you follow the intensity on a light ray, and you see what happens to the intensity. So the idea was to download RADMC, and I think you have all done that. And you have installed it, I think. So you are, let me do that. So can you read that? Okay. No? Better now? So we go to the SASFI hands-on session. And, yeah? Okay, that's the usual problem. Now it's better, right? Okay. So, what we need to do is we need to inform the computer code about the whereabouts. So we need to tell him, well, there's a central star in the center, what is its luminosity in which waveband. We assume that it is a black body radiator. We need to make some assumptions about the dusty envelope. We need to give it some density profile, and of course we need to give it some opacities. So if you read that, the problem is set up by this file here, the setup file. We can click on it, open problem setup. And you probably have done that. You see it defines first a number of constants, then parameters for the model. So it says something about the stellar radius here, for instance, the mass of the star, etc. This is the number of photon packages that are released. These are for the, should make it a bit larger. Now it's better. These give you some shortest wavelength, longest wavelength of the spectra to be calculated and considered. Properties of the dust shell, reference radius, etc., etc. Now, with this information for this analytic model, we need to make the model. So, first of all, we need to define the radial grid. And it is clear this is a problem that is not well suited for a Cartesian grid. So, what we do is we want to make a radial grid. And because the density is higher in the center, we will have unequally spaced radial bins. So they are more tightly connected or more tight together. It's more radii and they grow in size as we go outside. And initially we do something spherical symmetric as a start. And so here we define the radial grid according to the formula. We then need to put some density onto these grid points. We also need to define the wavelength that RadMC needs to do its radiation transfer. We have seen there's a minimum and a maximum wavelength. These have been given in micrometers. And then we need to calculate the stellar spectrum. And we simply say it is a Planck spectrum that knows something about the temperature at the stellar surface. The Planck spectrum, if you look at it, is here the function Planck that calculates for me the Planck spectrum. So now I have set up the model. Now I need to inform the computer program what input to take. And as with many complex codes, RadMC relies on quite a number of input files. The first one here is the grid. So RadMC is extremely flexible because you can tell it, you can teach it very, very different things. It is very flexible in terms of the grids it can use, in terms of other things you can do. So here is an input file where you give it the adaptive mesh refinement grid. So we don't use adaptive mesh refinement here. It's just you give it the grid. Then this is the dust density. This is the wavelength where you want to do your radiative transfer. You do it in wavelength bin. You need to define that. This is the star. Here you have a file that accounts for the dust opacities. That is an external file. And then there's a global input file that tells the code what specifications to use. So that is about this problem setup. And we try to run it. So we say gfortran problem setup 1 F90, and it compiles nicely. So now what we notice is if we then run the if you run this program, then I have a problem because my computer is not geared towards running stuff. Now it does do it, and we can now run RadMC and make an iteration on the dust temperatures. we have now the starlight from the central part. RATMC solves as the radiative transfer equation, and the question we are asking is, what is the dust temperature that we are getting? So, good. Let us look at what the dust opacity looks like. So for that, because I could not get Python installed with the MUT library, I had to do something more complicated. Where am I? So here we are. I need to run now nthought Python library. So that kept me busy this afternoon. This is some Python library that comes with matplotlib installed. So with that, and thanks to Eve, I can now look at my opacity table. So I can run this opacity table. If you have a proper Python installment, then you would just skip the first. Oh, this is too small. Can you read that? Oh. Okay, now. So I run that. And it gives me an error. So you probably also notice this error. The reason is that I should have changed the name of the opacity table. So I do that now. CP dust kappa silicate 1 goes into dust kappa silicate dot input. So now I do the same. I run the program again. And I see what my Python script tells me. It still gives me an error. Oh yeah, why does it do that? Because oh, the P, yes, thank you. Yes, thank you, that was very helpful. So this is now the opacities, and you see at small wavelengths, the opacity drops. The opacity goes. Goes up at high frequencies, and at small, at large wavelengths, small frequencies. The kappa drops, is that correct? Yes, so it absorbs low wavelength, high frequency material, and it emits it in this band. And there are certain features that are related to PAHs and other stuff. So now with that, we can run our RATMC and try to do the thermal radiation. So we type RATMC3D, Monte Carlo, thermal radiation. It has all the inputs already in the input files. And what it does now is it shoots the photon packages, and it informs me how many photon packages it has already shot away. And I will see that I have now a number of new output variables. So for instance, I have this thing here that is now the dust temperature. More dust temperature. Oh no, this is the wrong one. Here, this one. That is the data file. So this is a header, 200 cells across, it's a radial thing, and this gives me the temperature in Kelvin. It starts with something like 77 Kelvin, and it drops down to below 10 Kelvin. So what I can do now is I can plot the temperature distribution of this gas cloud. I can go back to my Python script, and I can run the plot dust temperature script that that Eve has provided. So where is it? Here, plot dust temperature Python. And it needs two things. It needs to read on the radial binning. So the radial binning is the AMR grid.input. Ah, it's okay, it's vice versa. But first it wants the dust temperature input. So I go back here and first give it as input the dust temperature data file and then the grid data file. Good. I plot that and I see exactly that I have very high temperatures close to the star. And this is the radius in logarithmic units. This is the temperature also in logarithmic units. And then I have roughly a power law decline. How far are you? Have you caught up?
Yes.
Where's the problem? Maybe the plot, if the plotting is the problem, then. That is a general. Then you're missing the matlib, however it's called. Matplot library. And you will not finish, you will not manage to get it installed within 2 hours. So it. Yeah, but it. So. Yes, it's not on the website. It assumes that you have a Python installation that has this plotting library. And I did not have it either. I had to install the, however, how is this thing called? The NSAUD Python distribution. So with that you can do it, but I think okay, if you can. So then I would say we continue. So the next question is, so how is the spatial grid defined, etc. Now compile it. We have calculated the thermal distribution of the dust, and we have plot the resulting temperature as function of radius. Now, what you could do is you could now voluntarily play a bit with your dust properties. You could give it a 10 times smaller and higher densities, and you can see how the temperature then changes. I will not do that, in particular if your dust gets too dense, and if you include scattering, then RATMC takes a long time. So let us jump over the voluntary things. I would encourage you to play with it just to see how changing dust properties, dust densities, will change the temperature distribution. I think that's very illustrative. Now, an observer would not see this radial profile. He would look at this core from the outside. He would observe it at different wavelengths, and then he would try to figure out what he sees. So the next thing is we try to calculate the spectral energy distribution. And for that, we call RATMC again, and do now the Monte Carlo line transfer to give us an image. So details on how this is done you find in the manual of the program. which I think is extremely extended and extremely useful also for as a general educational of radiative transfer. So I can only recommend it to you. I think it's an excellent program, and the tutorial and manual is very good. So for us, we follow the steps that we should do. We now simply want to calculate the image. So what we do is we go back to this part and we pump in RAD MC3D. And instead of asking it to compute the thermal energy with the Monte Carlo method, we tell it now calculate an SED. And the SED, it's basically calculating this image, and you can look at this image from different points of view. So you can define your position on this sky by an inclination angle and a position angle. And because it's spherically symmetric, that does not matter a bit here. So we can just take whatever we want. I take the one from the manual, inclination angle 45 degrees, position angle phi 30 degrees. And what happens now, it again calculates photon packages that it sends off. And it does it for all wavelengths at once, and it will take a while. If you increase the dust density, it will take even longer.
That is wrong because if you want to do the huge images, let's say if you have a PPV cube of 1,000 by 1,250 velocity cubes, then it can take a day or two. So Case is working on parallelizing it, but he has an engineer to help him doing that, but the engineer is more working on a graphics user interface. So we hope it will come soon. Rahul, any news on the parallelization of RADMC?
It's at least 6 months to a year away.
Okay, helas. So, we are done. So you see, for a very simple problem, it took on my computer a while. Now we have an image. And again, thanks to Eve, we can look at this image because we can, we can plot the spectrum first. The image is boring because it will be spherical. So we can say, run plot spectrum Python spectrum.out. We can just look at the spectrum out, and we see it is again simply a table. This spectrum is very simple because it is a radial profile. It has frequencies and it has, what am I saying? It has the frequencies in the left column and it has the intensity on the right-hand side. So what we see is then a spectrum like that. So can you guess which part is from from which of these physical entities? Where do you think this comes from? It's closer to where the star is, and this is then pre-processed stuff that has been. It's flux in units, which. Oh, in micrometers, yes. So we can look at what would happen if we put the dust to lower densities, if you remove 999 of the dust grains. What time is it? 38. Maybe I skipped it here. I have done that this afternoon. Maybe I can exit. No, quit. Yes. Then I go to copy. Then I should have here now two dust. Copy. So I should have here two no, I have removed it. Okay. Let us then not do the voluntary exercise, but go back to the next steps. Wrong. Okay. Good. So now what we want to do is we want to go away from these simple one-dimensional models, and we want to have a conical hole in this envelope. So the idea is that the protostar might have a disk initially, and the disk drives an outflow, and in the most simple approximation, we model this outflow as some kind of conical hole in this thing. In reality, this would be more V-shaped. And in order to do so, we increase the complexity of the problem. First, we now take a opacity that takes scattering into account. So we look at the dust kappa silicate underline 2. And you see it has now a third line that informs the code about the properties of the scattering. So we take scattering into account in this problem, which makes it to calculate even longer. So we copy dust kappa silicate 2, dust kappa silicate dot imp, and we look then at the problem setup, the F90 code. So open problem setup 2, F90. And we see again what we have seen before. Here is the Planck function defined. Here are our fundamental constants that we need. And now the model parameters have become a bit more involved, but not by that much. So in the make the model step, we see that we now have two grids. We make a radial grid, and we make a grid in angles. So now we have a radial and theta grid. Because we still have rotational symmetry, we don't need to make a three-dimensional grid in phi direction. If we had, let's say, a binary star, or if we had some spiral arms in the disk or more complex system, we could make that three-dimensional here. When we do the density, we need, of course, also tell the density that it now needs to write the density into a two-dimensional grid. The wavelength grid remains as it is, in the stellar spectrum also remains as it is. Good. The only thing that we have here now is that we include dust scattering in our in our opacity table. So we run that G Fortran problem set up 2 F90 R dot out, and we have now almost all we need. So we have run the problem setup, and we need to compute the SED now at different inclinations. Now it makes a difference whether we look basically along the hole directly on the stellar surface, or we look at the thing edge on, or at some angle in between. So what we do is we compute these SEDs, just like we have done it before. What we need to do first is we need to run the thermal Monte Carlo calculation. So we need to give, we need to feel the temperature of the dust. We need to determine the dust temperatures. So this is what we do with our first Monte Carlo iteration. So we have now also again a dust temperature dot file. And you notice it has now more cells. It is again a simple ASCII table, and when the code reads it in, it knows how to distribute it into a two-dimensional grid. Good. So the next thing we would like to do is we want to tell RUT MC3D that it should calculate the spectral energy distribution, SED, as before. But now we say an inclination angle of 0 degrees and again our phi of 30 degrees. And you notice it gives you more complex output because it also does the scattering. This will now run a while. Let me take the opportunity while this runs. No. And copy these two spectra. Copy spectrum I8. I've calculated those this afternoon. To the computer. So the output that the code will deliver is spectrum dot out, and it now looks a bit more complicated because it gives me a spectrum at different locations. Here it's still busy. Does some lambda iteration, etc., for the scattering processes. So maybe in the meantime we can look at the output. Here the AMR grid. This is our adaptive measurement, the AMR grid. This gives me the radial density profiles. This is what we want. We have a look at the dust density. You see it has a 1, it has the number of grid points, it has another 1, and then it has the dust density. This is in grams per cubic centimeter. Yes, in grams per cubic centimeter. And the dust, this is a dot file, has exactly the same format. This is now the new dust temperature. And we can already look forward while the computer is calculating what is the next thing we would like to do. So when we produce CO emission lines, we need to provide more data. Not only do we need to provide the dust opacity data for the dust temperature, we also need to provide it with the molecular cloud data, with the molecular transition data. And what we have done, we have gone to the Leiden database. We can do that maybe right now here. Lambda Leiden. So this is the Leiden atomic and molecular database. It gives you the atomic and molecular data for these number of species, and it is, for that purposes, one of the best databases. If you have other reactions or want cross sections, etc., there are other databases that provide you with other data. So we can. Oh no, this is not. So this gives you a reference how it is calculated by Flower, for instance. We shall see what our. Huh. Ah, yeah, it's done. So the computer is done. I have now the file spectrum.out, and what I can do is I can have a look at the spectrum. So I copy that first into this name so that it is informed that it is the one with the angle zero, and I can plot it. Come on. Run. Plot spectrum. Python spectrum inclination angle of 0 degrees dot out, and it is not found. Why? Huh. Where am I? Ah, okay. I was in the wrong. So, same again. Run plot spectrum dot Python spectrum 0 degree out, and I have these two parts. So. Again, I see part of the stellar spectrum. It is now very featureless because it is a black body, and I see then the emitted and reflected light of the dust. So if I were now to calculate the other inclination angles, I would, of course, see a different spectrum because I would obscure, if I look edge on, the central star, and I would see a more pronounced feature that comes from the dusty envelope. So where is that? So I have calculated that then for the next inclination angle, here 90 degrees or almost 90 degrees, and I have called it spectrum 89. So you can't do that. If you wish, you can do that at home. And you see it looks very differently. Now you see many, many dust features. So here you are, this is the stellar starlight, and here you are dominated still by scattered light. This is why it was important to include scattering in this process. Now if you look at the emission, you see again the features that have to do with the absorption by PAHs and so on. So you see a much more complex spectrum if you look at the thing edge on, and if you were to look at some inclination angle, you would see a line that lies somewhere in between. So what tells us this is that if you look at the spectral features, and if you have a model of the protostellar envelope of its geometry, say if it contains a disk or so on, you can try to invert the problem and learn something about the inclination angle and the disk properties. So this is what people usually do. Good. Are there questions or comments so far? Good. Let us switch that off. The fourth thing we would like to do is now we want to calculate the CO emission in addition. So what we can do is there are a few questions which I think would be good if you try to answer. If you look at that again, so you were asked to download not only the 1216 CO from the Leiden database, but also the other isotopomers, 13 CO, C17O, C18O. And if you notice, you will see shifts in the lines. Why will these lines shift? Proposals? No, even for the same angular momentum?
Different inertia momentum.
Yes, exactly, different inertia. And you can calculate it. I've provided you the formula. Good. So then what is the abundance of CO? For simplicity, we take 10 to the minus 4. And we can ignore helium or we do not ignore helium. So you can use that to calculate the opacities. But that has been done here already. So what we do now, in order to prepare you to do these runs yourself, we go back to the spectrum, to the dust opacities without scattering, because then it runs relatively fast, as we have seen. So we copy then dust kappa silicate 1, dust kappa silicate input. Good. So what we need next is we need to take the CO data file and call it molecule CO data file to be compliant with the RADMC input convention. So copy CO dot input in molecule.co.input. Let's see whether this is correct. Yes. Good. So next is we need to add a line to RADMC to the input file saying that we put the dust temperature equal, no, the gas temperature equal to the dust temperature. So we look at the RADMC3D input file. It is very simple, it has only one line. And I modify that RADMC.input file, oh, the D. And I append this line here, T gas equals T dust, T gas equals T dust. Equals unity, oops, d dot input, and now I have this line. So the next thing is we need to calculate the number densities. And that is a bit more tricky, because we need to have a file now for the number density of the CO molecule. And if you had other molecules, each of these molecules would need to have a file that informs the code about the number density in the cell of interest. The only number density that we have is, or the only density, mass density, is the one of the dust. So we go back to the program. So open program setup 2F90, and actually, we make it differently. I copy problem setup 2 F90 into problem setup 2B F90 and I modify that BF90 and I look at the regions where the dust density is written. So here it makes the dust density and it writes the dust density here. So this is where it writes the dust density. And I can simply say, oh, write a new ASCII table where instead you put the dust density is the number density of the CO molecule. So I need to see how I call this. I call it number dense underline CO dot input. So number dense underline CO dot input. And what I need to know now is how I get from the mass density of the dust to the number density of the CO molecule. So for that, I need several things. I need to assume a dust to mass ratio. So I take the standard value. I assume a dust to gas ratio of 100. So I multiply that by 100. This gives me now the total mass in gas. Good. Now I need to understand what is the total mass in in the CO molecule. So I need to multiply that with the 1.0 d minus 4 with the abundance. I take 10 to the minus 4 is the abundance. And now I have the mass density of CO. But I want the number density, so I need to convert the mass density into number density. So I need to divide by the mass of the CO molecule. And the CO molecule, we have 12C16O, so it weighs something like 30. Is that true? Thank you. But they have the neutrals also. Oh, thank you. You see, I'm already tired. Yes. Yes. So then I divide by, you said 28. 28. Now, I also need to divide by the mass of the proton. And the mass of the proton is given here in high precision units. Where am I? Here. So divided by the mass of the proton, mass proton. And now I should be in business. Let me save that. Let me compile that. G Fortran problem setup 2B F90. Let me run it. And now I should have a file that is called molecule.co.input. Ach. And that was the wrong file. We called it number density. Here, this one it is. More. So is this a reasonable number density? It's not unreasonable. Yes, should be right. Good. So I have this file. I also need a file that informs me about the gas velocities. And I can do the gas velocities by the same token. I can look at the RATMC manual, velocity, what information it needs to have about the velocity field. And it tells me that it wants a file gasvelocity.input. Can I get rid of that? Yes. And it wants basically three numbers. The three numbers are velocity in the x, y, and z direction for Cartesian coordinate or whatever in other coordinates. So it basically needs now, instead of having in the dust case more dust density, so instead of having only one input, it wants, because it has a vector, it wants three velocity components. So I can also use this thing here, and copy the number density file and paste it and call it now gas velocity, and I think we should end here soon. Gas underline velocity dot imp, and instead of outputting these things, I need to output my three velocity components, 0, 0, 0. I save it again. I compile it again. I run it. And I should have a file gasvelocity.input that looks hopefully like how it should look like. So if you go back to the thing, we now need a lines input file where you specify the to be used molecular data file. And that is the last thing I will be doing, because then the rest I think you can do yourself. Lines.input, control file. No, that was too much. So where do I find lines? Here, the line input file. So this is the form of the line input file. It has, again, the format. It has the number of cells. The number of atomic species. This is information about the number of atomic species. And this is for no scattering. But remember, we want to deal with scattering. If we deal with scattering, we can inform it about what our scattering partners are. So for us, this is the file we want. So I create it. Maybe I have done it already. No. So vi lines, no, line dot input. And I have two. Then I have one. Then I have CO. The CO comes from the Leiden database. Leiden, and I have one scattering, and the scattering is done by H2. So more line input, and now I compare it with the other line input I have done before. And it looks very similar. However, the name was not similar. Let me see. It should be line input. So maybe this was the reason why it didn't work this afternoon. So now I have my lines input file. And I can try to make the spectrum by, again, using RATMC to create the spectrum. You can look at the manual, or you can first, or see what I do. The first thing to do is I need to get the dust temperatures again. I need to calculate them again, because I have now a different scattering table. And I can make the spectrum, and maybe it works. So it doesn't work. So something is wrong. and I think this is a good point to quit. You can play with it. There must be some small detail that is missing here. No lines included. And I need to figure out some checksum error occurred. And I need to figure out where I made a mistake. If I manage tonight, I tell you tomorrow, then you can run it. Okay, we are again over time, and it's time for dinner. So.